I always say it's always interesting for me giving a class on Tish'a BeAv, unwashed, in old clothing, unbrushed teeth, and slightly dehydrated. It's like I'm really on. And not only that, I'm speaking to all of you, and then they're like projecting it in like the main hallway. It's like, okay. That said, Tish'a BeAv is definitely a time for learning and coming together as a community and for reflection. One of my problems, and this might not, you know, I always say for me there are two aspects of Tish'a BeAv that make it difficult for me to connect to it. Aspect number one is, like in my good summers, right? The good summers is that it's sunny out, and it's nice, and it's the summer, and we're in deal, and there's an ocean, and I'm not in a bad mood, and I'm feeling pretty okay, and it's like a hard, you know, like it's hard to take time out and become like sad and depressed. Like that's one version. I would say that's the least common version, maybe like the version of our children who are looking at us fasting and are so confused. I drop them off, I put them in the J zone, they're like, this is the best day. And they're not quite sure why I'm telling them, no, not today, because there's other little things we do. They wanted to go to like a funny movie. I'm like, mommy can't do that today. And they see that mommy and daddy are in a sad mood and something's going on, and I think there's that level of confusion. I think for most of us, though, look, there's seats in the front, there's seats over there, there's seats over here. For most of us, I mean, for me also, this other weird thing happens around Tish'a BeAv, which is I don't need any help being more depressed than I already am, right? The summer was a very difficult one for our community, for so many of us. We suffered many losses, important losses. Even if, aside from those things, I think that so much of human life is suffering. There is so much pain and suffering in this world. There's so much pain and suffering in the Jewish identity, just as being Jews, watching history unravel itself is painful for us. And some of my, this might be just for me, some of my resistance to Tish'a B'Av is, I'm already always in a little bit of this state, okay? And I think I spend a lot of my time not going too deep into this state because I don't want to get lost in this depression and sadness and pain and suffering. I want to be able to live my life. Tish'a B'Av, though, I think makes an interesting statement about this, which is, I mean, if you think about it, and we know this, when people say, what are we remembering on Tish'a B'Av? It's everything bad that ever happened in the history of Judaism, right? It's the destruction of the first temple, but it's also the destruction of the second temple. It's also the destruction of Beitar. It's also the Crusades. It's also the Spanish Inquisition and World War I and the Holocaust. And if anything else bad happens, please remember to celebrate it, to memorialize it on Tish'a B'Av. And here is something interesting already beginning, right? Which is that the rabbis say, and Judaism says, I want you to take all of your pain and suffering and sorrow, and we're gonna put a box around it, we're gonna encapsulate it, and we're gonna put it into one day. And as I was thinking about it, I was realizing that we play this dance of avoidance with suffering and pain, right? Which is, we're all feeling it all the time, and we're all trying to avoid feeling it all the time. Because it's always there, there's always in all of our lives some level of pain and suffering, we spend a lot of time trying not to look directly at it, trying to find a way past it, try to avoid it. And what we don't do or think about or spend enough time doing is what Judaism tells us to do, which is find a moment in time that you can locate and think deeply about your pain and suffering, not in the desire to avoid looking at it, not from a desire to look for the silver lining, not, okay, it's all gonna be better and it's for a reason, but just today we are in mourning. Today, we remember that there is horrible things have happened to our nation. Horrible things have happened to each of us. And today we say we mourn those moments. We suffer those moments. And we're going to suffer those moments together. And we're going to look at them starkly in the eye. Okay? Because spending so much time not looking at it has actually extended the pain. And Tish'a B'Av gives us a way of thinking about it that might help us move past the pain in a real way, instead of always being hounded by it. Yeah. I want to talk for a minute about this, this why Tish'a B'Av. What are we doing? What are we going to be thinking about today? And if you look at your first quote on your sheet, it's of course a quote from Elie Wiesel, who, if anybody has been coming to my classes for the past couple of weeks, you know I've been quoting him every single week since he died in the beginning of the summer. Holocaust survivor. I don't need to tell you who Elie Wiesel is, but this is my opening line for you, right? He asks this question: why write memories? Why share experiences? For the dead, it is too late. So before I read the second half of it, I want to linger on what he's saying, which is that we know Elie Wiesel dedicated his entire life to creating memories about the Holocaust for humanity. And his question is a very big question, which is, the dead do not know, right, that you are memorializing them. They are not here anymore. The tragedy happened. They are gone. The suffering happened. The destruction happened. So what are we doing this for? And his answer is, we do all this because it is not too late for our children. For all children, it is never too late. And so he invokes an idea that memory is not necessarily for the past, but the memory and remembering is a moral imperative for the future. That without memory, we lose the ability to teach our children what they need to know. He says, remembering the Holocaust is a necessity for our children. And I would say the same about Tish'a B'Av. What we are doing here today in joining together in pain and suffering is something that we do for ourselves and for the next generation. And we're going to explore together how that works and how Tish'a B'Av might work. The next little source over there is from, it's not really a quote from Yosef Chaim Yerushalmi, it's about his book. He wrote a book called Zachor, which of course in English means memory. And he talks about the difference between hidden memory, okay? So we might think that Elie Wiesel is saying we have to create history books about the Holocaust, right? We have to remember our history. We have to tell our children our history. And we find out that, in fact, history is meaningless and memory is everything. And what does that mean? What's the difference between history and memory? Read it with me. While both history and memory appear to be backward-looking, memory makes personal demands on the individual seeker. While history requires the painstaking, analytical amassing of facts and patterns, the skills of the scholar, memory moves us to empathy, to trans-historical purpose, and to existential engagement. Trans-historical purpose. So somehow, having a history, a known history of what happened to the Jewish people is not enough. So today, we are not commemorating history. We are enacting a memory. We don't just come to shul on Tish'a B'Av. We come and we sit on the floor, but it's uncomfortable, so we sit on chairs. So we sit on the floor and we live it, okay? We create an active memory of I today am in mourning. I am not today in historical memory. I am currently now in this moment in mourning. I am in a state of memory. Why? Because that will help me create empathy, trans-historical right? What do you say? Purpose and existential engagement. We're going to talk about those a little bit more. I want to go back to Elie Wiesel now in number three, and I want to read to you how he talks about his memories of the Holocaust. He says, I remember. It happened yesterday or eternities ago. A young Jewish boy discovered the kingdom of night. I remember his bewilderment. I remember his anguish. It all happened so fast. The ghetto, the deportation, the sealed cattle car, the fiery altar upon which the history of our people and the future of mankind were meant to be sacrificed. And now the boy is turning to me. Tell me, he asks, what have you done with my future? What have you done with your life? And I tell him that I have tried, to keep memory alive, that I have tried to fight those who would forget. Because if we forget, we are guilty, we are accomplices. Anybody who's read any of Elie Wiesel's works know that he is haunted by the voice of this boy. And this boy is him. It is his old self. It is his self that went through the Holocaust and watched his father die in front of his eyes and watched his family die. And you see that when Elie Wiesel is talking, that boy is, first of all, that he separates his present self from that boy, and he's in conversation with it, and he's telling the boy, I know that it is my responsibility not to forget you and to remember everything that you suffered and to make sure that your suffering does not become a historical data point but is an active memory in my life, because if I let go of the memory of it, I kill you again. I destroy you again. The destruction comes again with forgetting. And he says, I'm going to remember. And for the rest of his life, you see Elie Wiesel almost haunted. Okay, there's a shadow always next to him, standing next to him when he speaks of this young, suffering boy. And he holds his hand for the rest of his life. When I read this quote, right away, my brain went to something weird. Not weird, but interesting. Because I remembered another Holocaust survivor that I knew, Samuel Beck. Samuel Beck was a Polish Jew. He was an artistic prodigy at a very young age. When his family was put into the ghetto, he's one of those stories that they had an art exhibit in the ghetto. It was his art. He was 9 years old, okay? And I want you to look on your paper. You're going to see one of the paintings that he drew when he was 65. He's still alive. He lived in Israel for a while. He's now in America. But this picture on the left-hand side of your page is called self-portrait. If you cannot see it, we all have phones with us today. Feel free right now to Google Samuel Beck, self-portrait. And you can even look at others of his paintings. And we're going to make this part of the class slightly interactive because I'm going to stop talking for about a minute while you look at the painting and you tell me what you notice. And I want you to not tell me, but I'm going to ask you to turn to each other and tell me what you see in the painting. Okay? We're going to do that for 1 minute. So I'm going to ask you, I'm not going to take too many questions because there's a lot of us, or not statements, but does anybody have something that jumped out at them? Yeah. What? Kohanim. How so? So he's noticing these hands, he's surrounded by these hands, and your mind went to Kohanim, which is very, which is actually like a very interesting connection. Any other noticings? Yeah. There's a set of shoes with no one standing in them, right, in the foreground. In the background, you're going to see the many pictures of these young boys, but that empty set of shoes, right, that very powerful image. Others? Where's my art history majors? Yeah. There's rubble all over him, and she notices that there is a scroll at his feet, right? Although many people point out that these scrolls are tattered and they're on the floor, and it's a statement also about what happened to his faith, right? Which is that it was put into a severe crisis. In the background, you're not going to be able to see in your picture too clearly. There's smoke. Those are the smokes of the crematorium. Others, yeah. So what I didn't tell you, he's sitting in a sack, and if you don't have nothing about his life, I think you still feel that there's something very ominous about that sack around this young child's feet. It feels uncomfortable to look at it. In fact, Samuel Bach survived the Holocaust because his parents put him in a flour sack, and they dropped him out of the ghetto through a two-story window. And he stayed there for 24 hours till he was rescued by their housekeeper, who took him to a convent. And he and his mother both survived in that content. Every other member of his family died in the Holocaust. Yeah. So if you get a look, and I gave you a clue, there's these cutouts, the face of the surrounding this young boy that's surrounding him. And I was going to do a PowerPoint and I was going to show you, like, who is that young boy? But if it should have jumped out to you, that you know that young boy that he's painting. And that is the picture on your right. It's called the Warsaw Ghetto Boy. It's a very famous image from the Holocaust. You know, this controversy, did this boy survive or not? But most people say not. But interestingly, so when Samuel Bach is asked to paint a picture of himself, self-portrait at 65, it is a picture of himself still in that sack, still recovering, still in that moment, surrounded by these ghostly and multitudinous, there's so many of them, there's cutouts, these ghosts of the children that did not survive. And of course, he uses the image of that one child who did not survive. And Samuel Bach does not write about his paintings. So this is just an image. By the way, in his hands, which you can't see, is a paintbrush. And this idea that what is his life going to be now? It's going to be about how do I talk to people about this past, which will never be the past for me? How do I talk to people about the fact that I am both living and dead? And this is something we find in Holocaust survivors, that they are both alive and dead at the same time, that they have a living identity and a dead identity. And it's very hard for them to separate those two things. What I would tell you is that Holocaust survivors are not alone in this feeling. And this is going to feel a little weird, but what I would tell you, something to think about, and we're going to revisit this at the very end, everybody in this room has a little lost child inside of them that has been suffering anguish, okay? And if I ask, when we go into a state of memory and crying and destruction, we are not the people sitting in these chairs, these adult selves that have coping mechanisms, right? When we are in that place, we are little children. We are little children. We are innocent. We are unprotected. We do not know what to do with this suffering. We do not know what to do with this pain. We do not have coping mechanisms, okay? We are just in despair. What we're going to return to is that often when we're hurting each other or when we're not seeing other people, we don't realize that while we might be looking at an adult, we are also looking at a young, innocent child. And especially in our memories of destruction in the Holocaust, we remember the most innocent victims, which are the children. But everybody who died in the Holocaust was a child. Everybody was an innocent victim, everybody. Of course, the picture on your right is so important because what do we see? These men with guns and vests, and who are they pointing their guns at? It is only women and children. That's the only people in the picture. Last night we read Echa, okay? And in Echa, the prophet says to us, what he paints us a picture, and he says, I want you to know the women and the children were dying and were suffering. And he doesn't want you to forget that once, and it doesn't matter that it was 2,000 years ago, as Jews, your innocent children and women were dying in the streets. And that past is ever present for us. Because as Jews, we don't live in a single historical moment. We remember for eternity all times and all moments. I'll elaborate on it more, though. Very interesting. If you turn your page, yesterday, on Shabbat, we started Sefer Devarim. And I was reading Sefer Devarim, and something hit me in the face about it, which is that Sefer Devarim, a lot of parts of it make no sense. In that, what is it? We all know. Sefer Devarim is Moshe, at the end of his life, okay, is talking to the children of Israel, to the people of Israel, as they're about to go into the land. And I just want to tell you some things he was saying. He's saying, remember, and this is him talking, remember how we left Egypt and how we went from place to place. And remember you who are standing here, remember how God killed all of you. Because you sinned, and how you complained, and how your generation was destroyed. Does anybody see what might be a problem with that sentence? No? I will tell you. What? How do you talk to people who are dead? Did anybody feel it when they were reading? There's something weird about Sefer Devarim, which is he keeps saying to these children, remember when I got so angry at you? You're like, no, I wasn't there. I don't remember, okay? I'll give you another one. We'll look at it, this one together. This is the big one, okay? The top of it got a little cut off. But it says, remember, et ha-devarim, okay? Et ha-devarim asher ra'u enecha, upen yasuru milvavecha kol yimechayecha. He says, don't forget the things which your eyes saw in case they go out from your heart, okay? And from... he says, all of your life, kol yimechayecha, all of your living life, I need you to remember everything that you saw. V'hodatam lebanecha lebnei banecha. And you need to tell your children about them and your children's children. Yom asher amadeta lefnei Adonai Elohecha b'chorev. Remember the day that you stood in front of God at Chorev, which is Har Sinai, right? Be'emor Adonai Elai, hakelet li et ha'am, gather the nation for me. And let them hear what I have to say. So that they'll know to fear me all of their living days. And then they will teach it to their children. Right? And you all came near and you stood under the mountain. And it was, the mountain was filled with fire unto the very heavens, and there was darkness and a cloud and thick darkness. And this is where we get a tradition that every single Jew was standing at Har Sinai. Because right now, Moshe is speaking, and he clearly doesn't think that every single one of the people that he's addressing was standing there, but he has no problem speaking ahistorically. Yes? He has no problem saying, you were all there, even though they weren't all there. Because in the Torah, and in Judaism, and in the words of the Moshe, all Jews experienced all historical moments all the time. Which means we are all always at Har Sinai. We are all always hearing the word of God. We are all always suffering the destruction. The same way we are currently today re-suffering a destruction that happened 2,000 years ago, we are also capable of reliving a moment that is long gone, which is the moment when God spoke to us and gave us those laws. Because we enact memory, we don't enact history. Because we inherit all of this information and we live with it. And he goes on to say some of the most powerful words. Adonai Eloheinu karet imanu brit bechorev. God made a covenant with us at Chorev. Lo et avotenu karat Adonai et habrit hazot. God did not make this covenant with our fathers. Ki itanu anachnu ele po hayom kulanu chayim. But with us, even us, here, we, the living, today. Of course he made a covenant with the fathers, but it doesn't matter. Because the minute you are the generation that is alive, the covenant is now with you. Whoever is living in this room is covenanted. Whoever is living in this room is obligated by the covenant. Whoever is living in this room experienced the destruction of the first temple. Whoever is living in this room experienced the Holocaust. If we play the dance of avoidance with our memories, we will not be able to live our full lives and experience our full selves. I want to talk to you about something a little bit strange in the next 15 minutes that we have. We're going to go till whatever. We have time. I'm so not used to monologuing, people. I want to talk a little bit about epigenetics, okay? Look at the first page for a minute. There's a definition there. Epigenetics is the study of changes in organisms caused by modification of gene expression rather than alteration of the genetic code itself. What? Esther, I'm fasting. I don't know what you're talking about. My brother-in-law said, what are you teaching? What are you teaching? Epigenetics. I don't know what that is. Epigenetics. Where are you, AB? Are you here? Yeah. Okay. I was like, no, it's really interesting. He's like, okay, make it digestible. I'm not going to tell. Okay. So what is epigenetics? It's a very interesting thing. I'll try to read you another paragraph that I felt like explained it a little better. It says, trauma changes people permanently and in an enduring way. Understanding the language of epigenetics, the science of epigenetics, offers a very tangible way for understanding how environmental events can permanently change things. And it also offers a mechanism for potentially understanding how those changes can be transmitted to the next generation. Mm. Epigenetics is the study of not your physical genetics, right? But what they're discovering these days is that people have an epigenetics, which is aside from the code of your DNA, the events of your life, of your history, turn certain parts of your DNA on and off. And they notice that this happens, that if, especially around the idea of trauma will turn parts of your DNA on and off. One of the big people who study epigenetics is a woman named Rachel Yehuda. She's Jewish. She's a Jew, okay? I was like, wow, that is the most Jewish name for a Jewish epigeneticist. What she spent a lot of her time studying, first of all, her story is part of the story that I sort of want to tell, which is that she is the grandchild of Holocaust survivors. And of course, she decided to dedicate her life to studying the children of Holocaust survivors. She was very fascinated by her own parents because she was noticing certain trends. And what she was starting to find out is that there is an epigenetics to survival of trauma. And she started to think about the fact that the Jewish people might not just be giving birth to the next generation, but might actually be transmitting a way of existence genetically, because of their memories and their experiences and their traumas, to the next generation. I want to read with it, okay? This is number 5. Jewish culture and religion has understood that children bear the burden of their parents' legacy. Right? We just said it, for good and ill. We bear the parent burden of our parents' legacy. Fair or unfair, it's a fact. It's a cultural fact. It's a biological fact. Everyone is born with a unique set of genes. The task is to refine from these traits the best self that we can have and not get distracted by the traits that are weaker. Build up the traits that are stronger. What you have represented among children of Holocaust survivors is a preponderance of people that are in therapeutic positions. Right, professions. Doctors, nurses, social workers, psychologists. You have an extraordinarily large number of people that go into tikkun olam, fixing what's broken. I think that's also a response to cultural trauma. You can get stuck in the legacy of victimization, or you can say, no, 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 I am going to be part of the solution. I don't know why in Jewish culture you have an overwhelming response of, I'm going to make sure this doesn't happen again. Now, she's a Jew, but she might not be a good Jew, because she's saying, I don't know why in Jewish culture you have this thing that when Jews experience trauma, they say, never again. And the answer is that we've been trained to do this for 3,000 years. For 3,000 years, our epigenetics has trained us as Jews, first of all, to be tuned into trauma. We never let go of our memories. We never let go of our sadness. And to transform those moments, not say, it's okay, there's a silver lining, but to say, horrible things happen to people. We are going to be the force in the world that ensures that it doesn't continue to happen. That is our legacy. That is our role. If people don't want to look pain and suffering in the face, how can they get human beings to stop causing pain and suffering? If we on Tish'a B'Av are not willing to look pain and suffering in the face, we will not develop the muscles we need to make sure Tish'a B'Av does not continue to happen forever ad infinitum. I'm going to play you a short video at this moment that I feel encapsulates some of the messages that I'm trying to talk about around trans-historical purpose, around generation after generation of Jews developing muscles of empathy, and how you can't have empathy if you don't understand suffering, okay? Are we ready? Should we dim the lights? here's the thing. And we said it in the beginning of class. I told you that everybody sitting in this room really, in fact, is a very little child, okay? There's no one sitting in this room who has not suffered or is currently suffering or will experience suffering. The Jewish people say to suffering, I know you. I know you. I, as a nation, I am there. I am not immune to this. And out of the depths of my memory of knowing, I will respond with empathy. Out of the depths of my understanding of suffering, I will be able to respond with deep empathy. There's a quote on your sheet from Tehillim. It's from 126, which is very interesting, because that 126 starts with "Beshuv Adonai et Shivat Zion hayinu kecholmim," right? When God finally brings us to a very redemptive state, we're imagining that moment of redemption. But what I thought was very interesting was it speaks like this: "Hazorim b'dim'a b'rina yiksodu," right? They that sow with tears shall reap in joy. Very famous line. What I would ask you to think about, though, is the way I'm trying to talk about it is, I don't know that you could reap in joy if you didn't have part one, if you don't sow with tears. Meaning, how can we create a good world if we don't actually acknowledge the difficult and the crying piece, right? Haloch yalech ubacho, right? Nose meshech hazara. He that goes on his way weeping bears the measure of its seed, is in your English. But speaking with what we were talking about just now, the adults might be walking in a state of suffering, but they are carrying that epigenetic code, you know, that bag full of seeds that they want to plant for the future. Bo yavo b'rinoa nose alumotav. He will come home with joy bearing his sheaves. We will be able to create the next generation of profoundly wonderful people out of our understanding of sorrow. Viktor Frankl, of course, you're on the bottom there, is another Holocaust survivor. I always tell everybody read his books because it'll teach you how to live your life. And he says, "What is to give light must endure burning." A very difficult quote, but something to think about. I also am going to read you this poem, which is so strange. I did not have this. My Uncle Joey, who's here, my Uncle Joe Bennon, came over to me before class started, and he said, look at this poem. I think it's such a great poem. I'm like, are you joking? This is what class is about. It's a sad poem, but I'm going to read it to you because I really feel like it encapsulates this idea of ever-existing pain and sorrow. This is our 1 o'clock people coming in. Come. It's called, and I'm sorry you don't have it in front of you, so you could close your eyes and listen. It's called Ballad of the Seven. And again, written by a Holocaust survivor, Abba Kovner, translated from the Hebrew. A wanderer lost in a dense forest on a stormy night sees at a distance a light dimly shining out of a lonely hut. He knocks on the door, enters, and sees a young boy, age 9, sitting at the fireplace. "Greetings, my child." "Greetings, stranger," replies the boy. "Are you alone here?" And here the dialogue between the two begins. "No, sir, we are 7, father, mother, 2 brothers, 2 sisters, and myself." "Where is mother?" "Mother died." "Oh, then you are only 6, my child." "No, sir, we are 7, father, mother, 2 brothers, 2 sisters, and myself." "Where is father?" "Father was killed in the war." "Oh, then you are only 5. "No, sir, I told you we are 7, father, mother, 2 brothers, 2 sisters, and myself." "And your brothers, where are they?" "One lost in an accident, the other taken prisoner, never returned." "Then you are only 3. "No, sir, we are 7, father, mother, 2 brothers, 2 sisters, and myself." "Your sisters, where are they?" "One lost in the lake, the younger one coming to her rescue, also perished in the water." Then you are only one, my boy, alone, aren't you? No, sir, we are seven in this hut, father, mother, two brothers, two sisters, and myself. How can a man like myself and all other fellow survivors and our friends and people of goodwill everywhere, grown in years and mature, preserve that thing which the young boy kept in himself and expressed in his own childish way? Perhaps it is this memory that gives us the right to live and to go on. As long as there are somewhere such huts in this world, such hearts that beat with remembrance, we can turn again to field and sky, to beauty and joy, and say that our dear ones are here living among us, not as shadows, but as an essence of our lives. I think that's quite beautiful. The idea that the past is never past, the lost are never lost. They are always fragments of our lives. And the degree to which we can keep that memory vibrant and alive will be the degree to which we are able to lead good lives. We have 5 minutes left. The argument of the class is not to be misunderstood. Suffering is not good. Pain is not good. Sorrow is horrific. Unfortunately, in order to stop these things from continuing, human beings need to remember them, need to experience them again, need to live in them, like literally have them in them, and need to use them to transform existence. This also on Saturday, when we read Moshe's words to the Jewish people of, you are all the living here today getting the Torah. We also read, it's called Shabbat Chazon, Chazon Yeshayahu, the prophecy of Yeshayahu, which I will share with you, okay? It starts, Shem'u Shamayim v'hazini eretz, ki Adonai dibed. Listen, listen, skies and heavens and earth, listen, right? Banim gidalti v'romamti v'hem pashu bi. I raised and grew children, and they have rebelled against me. Yadashor koneh v'chamor evus ba'alav, Yisrael lo yada amid lo hitponen. He says, even an animal knows who his father is, who his progenitor is, but my children, they don't realize. And this is the cry of the prophet. The cry of the prophet is, who is he talking to? He's talking to any generation of Jews and saying, how could you have forgotten? Now, for us sitting here today, we're like, how could we have forgotten? It happened 3,000 years ago, okay? It happened 2,000 years ago. And the prophet says, you can never forget. You can never forget any of it, because to forget is to forget God himself. And he goes on to say, listen, because of this forgetting, you fell into evil habits, you made bad choices, and now your temple is destroyed, everything is gone, you are overthrown by strangers, there is abandonment in the world. And he speaks to us and he says, you are like Sodom v'Amora, and I need you to listen. And then the prophet goes on to say, I don't, what we always say on a fast day, because we have to remember it on our fast days. And then he says, I don't need your fast, which we always forget. As Jews, we keep thinking that God is going to be so psyched that we're doing all these rituals for him. Like, hello, points. Like we do. We have like a cha-ching, like register, right? Like I fasted the whole day. And God, and every single time, every single prophet says, I hope you don't think that your fast is powerful, okay? I hope you don't think that your fast is magic. I hope you don't think that just because you went to shul and you bowed during Amidah, that suddenly everything in your life is going to be fine, right? As the prophet says, God does not need your korbanot. He doesn't need your worship. I mean, it gets pretty vicious. He goes on to say, right? Lo tosifu havi menchat shav, ketoreto evahi li. Chodesh v'shabbat, kro mikre, lo uchal, even v'atzara. God says, your holidays and your Shabbats and your whole thing. I can't stomach it anymore. It's nauseating to me. Why? Again, Chatshechem Moedechem, San'an Nafshi, Hayu Alay L'troach, Nil Eti Neso. He goes, I can't handle the burden of it anymore because your hands are stained with crime. Yedechem Damim Maleu. And in the Torah, what we don't realize is we keep thinking about reward and punishment. But really what God is saying is, if you are a people that are not every day enacting goodness to each other in your society, building a new world, right? Then your prayers are meaningless, and your acts are meaningless, and your rituals are meaningless. And this is what God ends by telling us, like, where do we go from here? Where do we leave this room? And nobody should leave this room because there's something coming up. But where do we leave this room? Where do we take it, right? He says, Rachatsu, Hizako, Hasiru Roa Malalechem Minegerenai, Chidlu Harea. I mean, there's not a better way to say it. He says, stop doing bad things. That's like, what's the deep message of the Torah, right? And it's like the deep message is, Chidlu Harea, please stop being bad. What is bad? He'll tell you, okay? This is what you need to do. Limdu Hetev, learn. Learn a lot. Learn how to be good. Dirshu mishpat. Seek out justice, always. Seek out justice. Ishru chamotz. Shiftu yatom. Rivu almana. Aid the wrong. Uphold the rights of the orphan. Defend the cause of the widow. I was going to end on another video, but I wasn't going to make you watch two videos of... And this is where I would end, which is the nation of Israel has been very lucky in the past, this generation, to see the rebuilding of Sion, to see Yerushalayim back in our hands. And one of the most powerful things, I think, for all of us, and we send this video out to one another, is watching what Israel is capable of, which is that when something goes wrong in Haiti, the Israeli Defense Forces are there building medical centers. When something goes wrong in the Philippines, we are there. When something goes wrong around the world, our voice is the voice that says, we are here in the face of your tragedy to protect you because we know what tragedy is and we'll never let it happen again. And everybody in this room, to the degree that you are able to tap into suffering and pain, to the degree that you're able to look into yourself and say, yes, there is this little thing, this little person inside me that is in pain, and connect that to your Jewish history and to your Jewish memory, and transmit that to your children, and let them inherit your suffering. Don't protect them from suffering. Suffering is fine. Suffering is part of life. Don't anesthetize yourself from it. Look at it, experience it, and let it transform all of us. And with that, we'll be able to say, Tiskul Lirot B'Nechmat Zion, we should all give comfort to one another on this day. Thank you.